Cinnamon Cooney, your art Sherpa, and today I'm going to show you how to paint this stunning painting that you can do. I want you to do this at home. I'm going to show you everything you need to know to complete this project. On the mic is my husband today.
Hi, guys.
Actually, he's my husband every day. I don't know why I was like today. It's not, you know, doing this for like 20 years, so every day is my husband.
Every day I'm your husband.
He tracks me with cameras and keeps track of the sound, but he also does the very important job of reading your questions on live events. If you have questions, put them all in caps. People with wrenches are moderators, and they try to make sure that we see as much of it as we can. But remember, sometimes we've already answered a question, and that might be early in the video, or sometimes the chat is just going by really fast, and we miss one, but just keep putting them in caps. We're going to do our best to catch as many as we can today.
Absolutely.
If you didn't already see it, there was a how to draw this and how to get better at drawing Asian eyes, how not to westernize them. And that is it, TheArtSherpa.com. Big art quest pages. There is a direct link in the description below along with the materials. So if you're like, oh, I want to just like freehand this in. But if you didn't want to freehand this in, of course, we're going to have a traceable, which will also be there really, really soon. I think it's being wrapped up.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So here she is. She's gorgeous. This is a really interesting one because I'm certainly inspired by Asian culture, but not informed enough or not versed. That's not my field of study. And so one of the things that's interesting as an artist is drilling down on these, mm-hmm. right? And then also then going back and doing more research and thinking to yourself, like, what would I change? What would I do differently from a more informed place? Because as artists, we're world builders. I really love her. I love her limited palette.
Mm-hmm.
I loved her dramatic makeup, which was certainly inspired by current models and influencers in modern Japanese culture that were happening, and I love the implication of the embroidery and just how very dramatic she is. So this is a black gessoed canvas,
mm-hmm.
and I black gessoed it myself. You can buy these gessoed and ready to go, or you can just get yourself some black colored gesso, right? They have almost all of the good pro companies have tinted gessos. So here's my straight review on this stuff. It's a little more effective than you tinting it yourself. When they tint it at the factory, you get a better, deeper pigmented tint than necessarily toning your own. But of course, you can tone your own gesso. If I was trying to get a true black, I'd probably put it into a clear gesso, not a white gesso, because a white gesso would give me gray.
Right.
Because it would already have pigment in it. So that would be how I would do that if I just wanted to make that up. And can you use black paint? Yes, of course you can. Black paint totally works. I sketched her in with, and I don't know where it went. Now, a white chalk charcoal pencil. There it is. I'm going to sip my coffee. So, Generals makes these charcoal pencils. They're great for the drawing portion of what we do, and they always kind of include these charcoal whites. I like these because they disappear really well into the pigment, and they just have a beautiful, you can see this beautiful sketching persona. So, she's drawn in, and she's ready to go, and I'm ready to coffee up. And we're going to talk about this very limited palette, which I love. Get ready for limited palettes because I love those.
What did you mean by limited palette?
Not a lot of colors. Some of my very favorite, most realistic portraits are with three colors. And I mean that I'm including the black and white.
Really?
Like, yeah. Not like, you know how like three marker challenges, they're like, okay, the white paper doesn't count and this black pen does not count.
Right.
In painting, you actually have to count all the colors.
Ah. So there's a little...
So a lot of times I'm doing a one-color or three-color challenge. I'm just forgetting to shout that out there. If I don't have to count the white or the black, wow, I can do anything. Anywho.
So it's a different thing there.
It's a different thing there. So here's our limited palette. Not a lot of colors. So we have yellow ochre.
Mm-hmm.
We have burnt sienna. We have the titanium white. I'm going to be using the black gesso because I would already have this out. But listen, you can use any black you have. This is the naphthol red medium. And what I'll say about this is a cool red. So if you see the usual cadmium we use, see how very orange it is?
Yeah.
So whatever red you use in your acrylic paint, just make sure it's more of this deep blood-inspired red instead of a warm orange-inspired red. Right? Like bird. See?
Bird.
So like just bird. Something to think about. That bird is there, right? Whereas some other things, now I'm using Prussian blue. I really like Prussian blue. I think it's a wonderful color to have in the palette. I mean, if you get indigo, there's certain blues that are just fun to have. Use whatever blue you have. This is just for a highlight in the hair in on the kimono, and so therefore is not incredibly important, is what it is. I just really think the Prussian pops in this environment. I'm going to be really working my palette knife.
Yeah.
A lot. Most of her gets painted, almost all of it, in yellow ochre, the naphthol, and the white. Just really, really, we're going to live here. Look at that.
Whoa. That was not me. See, there's no crimping on that one. That one was just all...
No, I just can't operate the... We were talking about this morning how I cannot operate the lid. Hey, everyone, watch me screw on a lid. That's exciting video. Woo-hoo! Sorry. I'm also going to be using acrylic glazing liquid today, which was hidden behind my jar. Here's my feeling on this. I love it. Obviously, acrylic paint thins with water. But one of the challenges to acrylic paint is that it tends to dry very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I hope I get through these plops of paint. My yellow hands. Very, very quickly. But if I were not to, this will help me slow down the drying time of that. I could also mix this into each of these to slow down their drying time with my palette knife.
Really?
You know what I mean? I'll show you. So I could go like this and put a little here. I wouldn't want to put a whole lot. Right? But then I could go like that. And this would dry just a little slower. And the thing about this product is I don't have that thing where I can only do like 30% before the paint breaks down. This is a glaze, so I can just use how much I feel like. So that would be an example. I guess I could... I don't know if you guys knew about that you could put it directly in the paint.
I had never even thought about that.
I haven't been doing it, but honestly, as fast as my paint's been drying, I'm kind of inclined to now. My studio is very hot and dry. Dry is the big part. If you're in conditions that are very arid, you're going to find that your paint will dry maybe quicker on you than you want. But you don't want your paint never to dry. The whole point of painting acrylic is it's a speedy process.
Mm-hmm.
And see, I'm just using my little palette knife to incorporate that. Sure, I'll be putting in a lot more red. The gesso won't dry out on me as quickly, so I don't really worry about that. Also, it's so cheap, I don't care. It just doesn't matter. I'm not going to put out any of the brown.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess I could. Then it's out, right? Then it's out. It's for her eyes. That way I can lay them in.
Georgia was asking, can I use
Georgia.
Alizarin crimson or quinacridone magenta?
Yeah. The quinacridone magenta will just give this a very poppy pink feel.
Oh, cool.
Look, the only thing that's going to happen on this one, a lot of times on limited palettes, how it will impact you is that it may be warmer or cooler than the painting or photograph that you're referencing. That's what you're... Because you're not doing a lot of mixes here... You're not going to get hit that hard in the end result. Just kind of an interesting side effect. So we're going to start, we're going to mix a little base skin tone here. Which is not really skin tone because we're talking about her makeup. So I'm going to come here with a little of my red and my ochre. And you can see I'm making ranges of this. I'm sort of like smush, 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 smush. This is the best part of, you could just be here all day being like, I'm going to paint this. Now, take a little bit over here to the white, making this hot. Now you see it goes into this very peachy tone. Look at that go.
It's very peachy.
Very peachy.
I have this, I think, somewhere. Oh, look, there it is. Picture in picture for you.
Picture in picture.
We got the picture in picture.
Oh, I love picture in picture. This is wonderful. So one of the first things that I want to do is I want to start creating this implication that there's skin tone showing through the makeup. So I'm going to take, this is a really interesting tool. This is a 3/8 filbert grass comb. A lot of times when you work portraits, and we're going to talk a little bit about filberts today. You can do these all in brights too. You don't have to be using the brushes I'm using. I'm just showing you some cool stuff you could do. If this bracelet gets in my way, it's going to go. My bling may be interfering with my art today. So right here at the hairline, I want to start putting, it is interfering. Bye-bye, bracelet. That's why I don't wear jewelry. I like it. It's like my favorite.
It just sometimes is.
Sometimes it
counterproductive.
Messes with me. Sometimes it is. You can, you know, if you want it to be even pinkier and more blushed, you can add a little more red to it. We're going to be working these values for a bit, so settle in and enjoy. Right? See how this is just starting to come in? I actually like the depth of the black canvas under this. If you're wondering why I didn't do this white first, I like the depth.
Oh.
So it gives me some space. I'm going to come around the side of her face. I love this because of its sharp edge, mm-hmm. but it also does a really soft blend. Filberts are wonderful in portrait painting, which is why you see a lot of oil painters use them. They tend to be a little long in length out for acrylic painters, which is why you don't see them using them as much.
Ah.
Coming around the edge. Everywhere there's almost an edge in her makeup, we're going to have varying levels of this rosiness popping out. Kind of an interesting thing. I'm going to just feather this. And so I'm going to start working this around. It's super fun for me. Super fun for me. Sorry.
But you really do. You know, that's the part of this is that you should be having a good time during this.
I do.
You know.
Put a little rosy tone under here. Even though I'm going to come back with a whole bunch of stuff. It makes it feel like it went away. It'll be there talking to me. So, see, I'm just working this out. Areas that are going to be really important is the shadowing under the nose. Around the chin. And of course, we really talked about these eyes. I don't know, maybe you'll resolve very quickly. I will be working the eyes for a while.
Yeah.
Now, I do an interesting thing. I'm going to take a smidge of black. And I gray my pink out. See how I've done that?
Oh, yeah.
And I'm just trying to find a very grayed pink. And then I'm going to come right into my white. Making this very kind of... See, now this gray has a pink hue to it. And I'm going to start working this through. But it's not bright white. It's definitely a grayed.
Now, Irene white. Has a really good question here.
I have a really good answer.
Where does this fall on the hoot scale?
This is... Honestly, she looks like she's about a 2-hoot, but she's really a 3-hoot.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of layering, blending, and glazing in her face.
Mm.
There's a lot going here to make this a beautiful dramatic piece, which I know is what you guys are going for. It's what I was going for. You know, so we'll be here a second. With her, what I'd say your major job is as an artist is to not get frustrated and give up and realize there's layers. I'm going to be done with her in probably anywhere between an hour 40 and 2, I think.
Okay.
And if that's true, you might be with her for more hours than that. Don't worry about that. That's okay.
Yeah.
You know, not a problem. So I'm adding more of my gray hair. You can always come. It's interesting. You can then add pink in it if you need to rosy it up. See?
Mm-hmm.
And this is the magic of a limited palette. Is it will allow me... Come right here on the side of my nose, following up this curve. So I'm going to be putting highlights and shadows places, but knowing where my dark values are coming around the front, there'll be a lot of adjusting at the nose. I can tell you this right now. So much. And I'm just blocking in, right? Block, block, block. I love blocking in. It lets me know where I'm going to go, man, so I don't get lost. Come here. Just don't want to be lost. I don't want to be lost. Pull this down a bit. And just having some fun and back into the white. But the white is not white. See, it's off-white. It's a little bit rosy. It has... just this glow underneath it. In the layers that we're going to be talking about, creating shadows and values, are how this it's very difficult to get this sense of the makeup feeling Mm-hmm. Because you have to show that there's skin tone underneath. If you remove all the skin tone and take all of the different variances out, it will feel as if the image is completely flat.
Oh, wow.
And not be as enjoyable for you. I love getting these. Come right under here into the chin. Little value, little shadow value. Little shadow value right here. Stronger at the ear. And the ear actually comes up in quite a strong shadow value as well. Around the... And you can just see I'm just really not changing a lot of brushes. I'm just blocking in. Trying to say where we'd see more shadow. We're going to see a stronger shadow pulled almost in a triangle right here. Definitely use the painting as a reference. See how I blocked out the values. One trick you can do is, besides, you know, working on pencil studies, things for yourself.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that you can do, grabbed a little red there. Is you can, grab some of that orange. So have fun here, just finding the different space. Is do a tonal study in pencil. Helps as well. Things you can have going on.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to pull some more white in. Under here. Just layering. So I wish I could say she was a super fast painting. But we'll be with her for a minute.
Yeah.
If you paint out any of your features, don't worry. You can put them back in with paint. And don't feel like using the traceable means you're not really, you know, doing the painting. That's not how that works. Just trying to talk about all that. Definitely want this darker value under the nose. So here under the nose, we know that there's the top of the lip. And I want to, a lot of how this is going to come together is the shading and the shadows.
Mm.
So I'm really, really going to have to work those as much as possible. You know, and I'll be coming back with highlights and shadow features, you know, quite strongly. Get a little of this.
Now you're still using that same filbert, right?
I am still using the same filbert. It's a very comfortable little filbert. Doing what I ask. It's being super obedient. I'm going to come right here and just add a little bit of a shadow. Apply one coming off here. Maybe take a little bit of the shadow and blend it out. And come back and resolve it again in a second. It's important stuff under the chin. Now, when I'm coming at the neck... Interestingly enough, I'll make this very, very dark color. It is almost as dark as the background.
Mm-hmm.
And you want it to fade into that darkness, that dark value. I'm going to mix some of my mid-gray. This is very much, if you've enjoyed tonal studies in the past, this is a good way to start playing with color. But still stay in the safe space of a tonal study. There we go.
Oh, wrong button.
Wrong button.
I'm just pushing the wrong buttons today.
And come along the front here. I know I need to pull a slight highlight in. Just a little bit of light will be catching that. I love just getting bits of my mixes in there. It's very helpful. Get some of this orangey mix. Look for different little, is this warm? Is it cool? Does it pull up the piece forward a bit?
Now,
and if you go over, remember, you can always come back with a black gesso.
Okay. I was going to say, Sonia was just asking that. I just wanted to double check. Is it okay to go back?
Yes.
To black, to white, black and white gesso to make the background black again?
Yes. It's so is okay to do that. It's completely okay to do that. Get right back into my gray. Now I'm going to wipe this brush off because it's got quite a lot of pigment on it. Come into this. Even with all of this, I'm going to mist right about now. You can notice, though, that I'm not needing to get in my water very often.
Yeah.
And a lot of that is that I've added that glazing medium to the paint. Coming around with this brighter highlight at the bridge of the nose. Again, just blocking this in. We'll be adjusting it, moving it, thinking about it as I'm putting her in. She was a lot of layers. I was talking to John about this as I was going. When we get into her hair in a kimono, it's like a light exercise in expressiveness, but in her, especially in this area of the face, to get this effect, this very emotional effect, it's going to definitely take some layers. How are we doing on making our skin mixes in these really unusual colors?
Now, there was actually a question about color mixing here real quick.
Happy to answer. So demo Gail, anything.
She was asking, is there any reason why I can't mix black gesso with black paint?
No.
No?
So here's how gesso impacts your paint in your brushes, is that it's got a lot of grit in it, tooth.
Yeah.
And it can wear your brushes out if you, like, you know how some painters paint with a lot of gesso?
Right.
Their brushes just wear out a little quicker. It's not bad. It's just part of their practice.
Ah. Now,
so if you're like, man, these brushes have to, like, last a while, then in brush care you may want to sand your canvases and, you know.
Now, is there a difference between carbon black and Mars black?
Yes. Yeah. And we have a quest on black paint that actually goes really deeply into that.
Cool. Should we maybe I card that in here for people or put it in the description afterwards here. We'll see if we can do that for the time travelers.
Yeah, for time travelers. Yeah, the way the blacks are different. So I'm just putting this in. I think I want to just come along here a little bit.
Oh, so one of our own Miss Ghost Hostess has joined us.
Ghost Hostess.
And so she has a new little brush that should be joining us around November 15th.
Congratulations! Mm.
So that's awesome.
That is beyond awesome.
We like little brushes around here.
We do. And like a bunch.
So
I'm taking this shadow and coming underneath my nose. A lot of this painting is accomplished in the nose. And I know a lot of you guys feel like, oh, the nose is like my nemesis.
The nemi-nose?
The nemi-nemi-nemi. Of it. So I'm pulling this. So see these kind of rosy grayed shadows. These are colors you would not necessarily think to use when painting this. And I think that's why, and the way this is layering out, I think that's why some of these pieces don't maybe get done as often as they could, is because it seems crazy and foreign on how to get them done. I'm mixing a much lighter color. I'm going to wipe off the pigment off my brush here. Like you do.
Like you do.
Like you do. And I definitely know, top of the lip, I'm going to say that there is a highlight here. See that strong highlight I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm. You fake me out every once in a while.
I do?
You go to look over your shoulder at the reference, and you're not going for paint. And I'm like, oh, and I miss it.
I'm just getting this lighter value. I'll come back with a good shadow under the chin, but I just want to talk about this space right here. One of the things that you don't want to do is make hard flattening lines when you're doing faces. So it's great to use these value changes to identify where the face plane begins and where the neck begins. I'm going to pull this highlight up here. And I'm going to say that we have a shadow that's happening here. And start blending it out this way, like you do. Glazing is fun biz. I know this seems overwhelming, but I promise you portraits really are just about hanging in and hanging on.
Mm-hmm.
And be easy with yourself. Be like, you know, don't be like, I'm going to see. Now, here's where this is really lovely. So it's a filbert and it's a grass comb. And if I get a glaze, then I can come here and look at this crazy soft space I can create.
Oh, wow.
Isn't that wonderful?
It is.
Cool,
it's just
cool.
Like, doot, doot, doot. It just, you know, it should come with sound effects.
It should. Cool tool. You can get these anywhere. You can, you know, what you're looking for is a filbert grass comb. This is a 3/8 by a, it's a ruby satin.
Uh-huh.
Right? So you can get these wherever these are, but that's what you're looking for is grass comb, filbert. Like Neat. This one because it's for heavy body paint. That's where I would say you have trouble with some of the other grass combs is they just aren't maybe for heavy body paint. And you need a brush for heavy body paint, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just keep working my nose here. I live for my nose. Just creating that slope. Yes, I'm going to come back with red and stuff. And we talked a lot about, you know, lid and everything. One of the tricks here is we're going to want a dark, rosy underbrow. So, yes, it will be gray. Before we put the black on, it's going to have like a rosy, rosy tone. I'm just going to work that in. I may move these if I don't like their placement. And we talked about this in the thing, but, you know, remember about your lineup of your nostril and the inside corner of your eye to your eyebrow. And that this can go just a little bit past the edge. And then we had some different considerations when we're doing eyebrows that are Asian. And so those are things to think about.
Mm.
About the directionality of line and hair.
Now that brush is called a filbert grass comb.
Mm-hmm. This is a filbert grass comb.
Okay. So it's they're just like, seriously? Grass comb?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. It's just.
And it does exactly what you're thinking it might do with that name.
It
by
combs
the way,
the grass.
It combs grass. So it's a really wonderful tool. What it is oil painters have a lot of these filbert tools. And because filberts are length out long, like a flat. A lot of acrylic painters may not necessarily gravitate towards that.
Ah.
Because they don't have enough authority to move it on the canvas. But, you know, all that being said, so I'm coming there, I'm trying to make this triangulated slope here. I'm trying to work that out. Work it out.
Like you do.
Like you do. Blending it out, working it out. Making sure I have a nice. You don't want to do any nasal work on anybody. Sometimes I find myself being a plastic surgeon when I don't mean to be. And so it's just important to, you know, be thinking about those things as you're working. Okay, there we go. I'm going to lighten this space a bit right here. Just softly, because I want this to be a little bit more in shadow than the other side, and I want there to be this beautiful shadow underneath. I'm going to start creating those shapes and a little bit of that pinkness to my brush, thinking about these things, having fun.
Now, Sasha was asking, why not paint the face white to start with?
Well, because I like the depth that this dark canvas creates for me for my working point.
Huh. So this is just how you artistically approached the...
There's not usually one way to skin a cat. Not just that everybody paints a portrait using a glazing method.
Cats should be kept as pets.
Yes, you're right. I'm very sorry. Please, internet, don't come for me. Know what I was thinking? I guess I just thought yesterday's trolling was not enough. Let's go fishing. So I'm trying to create a little shadow space that is pulling in to create some shape here. And I might rosy up this shadow space to create some shape here.
Mm.
Around.
So I had another interesting question that, let's see here. Oh, there's actually a few of them that have scrolled.
I like
up
interesting
here, so
questions. I'm going to lighten up. Just working it, man.
Trina was asking, how do you figure out how much brow bone should show? I have trouble with the spacing between the eye and the brow.
Well, there's some math, there's some face math, but really what you're looking at is how much, because eyebrows can be quite high or quite low, right? When you're looking at your reference, use things like fingers, like other objects to get a sense of distance.
Yeah. Now, there was another text.
And we're going to do a really cool video on brows. We are.
And there's another Texan out there who's having some trouble, and it seems that she...
Just wiping off and mixing.
She's temporarily had to set up her studio in a Texas garage.
Oh, and so you and I, man, get some glazing medium.
So she's having trouble when, I'm not sure if this is storing her paints or
in general. Oh, yeah, all of it.
Yeah, so she was asking for some guidance here, and so...
It's our struggle, and if you're in an area that doesn't have ideal paint conditions, like we are in Texas, I'm going to create this highlight right here, then you're going to be dealing with that.
So, yeah, it's generally, for most manufacturers... will tell you that their paint is fairly durable and can withstand a wide temperature range. But in practicality, you should keep your paint in the same temperature range that you would keep a pet.
Yeah.
So if you keep it stored in a cool, dry place, then it will last a very, very long time.
Same thing with your canvases, because acrylic paint softens in heat.
Yeah. And
heat does impact, your paint.
And light can as well. So you don't want to store necessarily your clear tubes of paint.
I'm
going to
get into a fiddly brush.
Yeah, in the sun.
This is a Filbert grass comb, 1/8 inch. But you're talking about, you could do a small bright, right? You could do like an equivalent to this would be...
Could you hold that real still near her
I'll
nose?
I'll show you a bright that's about the same size, like a 0 or 1 bright.
Yeah, hold it up against her cheek there next to her nose so I can see that. So you can really see how transparent that comb gets there at the tip to allow that cool action. Okay. It's neato. I'm just checking that out.
Just things that you could let into your life. I'm going to get a little of my black paint. I'm going to come under my nose here. Her nose dips down a little bit. My paint is skinning, John.
Yep. Well, that's
Texas.
Texas.
So I'm going to come down under here. I'm going to come up for this nostril. We remember we talked about this nostril is bigger. Just barely feathering that down. Right? And then I'm going to come over and this much more diminished nostril. Now I feel like I put that shadow in too deep. So when that's dry, I'm going to definitely be lightening that up. I'm making some of this deep shadow here, slightly rosy purple tone, get a glaze in it. And I'm going to come underneath this. Definitely cast that. This is like, honestly, this is the weirdest thing, but it's like my favorite part of the painting. This shadow.
Now, even in your shadow, you're allowing the lights and the darks to mix on your brush.
Yeah.
That's interesting. I hadn't noticed that before. I know that, you know, I noticed you do it in like different colors.
Come under this nostril right here. Look at that. Suddenly her nose is starting to have a thing.
It's gone all ruby rock.
Make a very light line here. Now we have some nose happening.
Ah.
Because that's what we want, is some nose happening.
You
want
to see the
nose. I'm going to add a little white.
Because the nose knows.
The nose knows. The nose happens.
Wherever you are, there's a nose.
Just trimming this down, trying to get this really delicate little shape here. And then I'm going to do an interesting thing. I'm going to take this weird highlight that I have here. Doesn't feel like a highlight, but it's lighter than some of the space around it. And I'm going to curve this nostril in a little bit. Look at how that goes into that space.
Mm.
And I want a little bit of this darker value there to define, to clip, to show the space between those two things. And that's a lot of what we're going to be doing, is how do we show the slope of something or the way something... See?
Yeah.
And a lot of this piece for me is in her nose. Just for me.
Yeah.
I'm going to rinse this out. That wasn't really rinsed out particularly well. I have some other filberts.
Okay.
Two, so don't...
Are they also
here.
Grass
I'm just
comb?
Really liking these two, so it's like, why change?
Are they grass combs or are they just...
Filberts.
Regular filberts.
Yeah, just regular filberts.
Because I'm fascinated. Now I want to have a grass comb and a deerfoot stippler and do a nature painting with the two of those. Maybe a cloud brush.
Yeah, I'd say a cloud brush. The deerfoots, the problem with them is that they're great for softer bodied paint.
I just
like them quite a lot for that, and they do some really cool patterning.
I like saying the word stippler.
I do too.
Especially a deerfoot stippler. It's just, you know.
But just something to think about, you know, when you're an acrylic artist, is what's the body of my paint? What am I asking it to do here?
Mm-hmm.
Just coming here with just a little bit of highlights here. But keeping that. Gotta keep it.
Keep it.
Keep the shadow. Got my glaze going now. Pulling this little gray. And I'm going to start trying to create a more neutral value system.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of this comes back as we highlight it up. So I'm adding more white to my brush. I'm still going to glaze, though, because I want a little of what's behind to pull out. So I'm going to come here on this nostril, just a titch. Just a little bit, just soft, soft. Soft matters here. Little come around. I want the shadow to be here, but I want it to be a little diminished, right?
Mm-hmm. So Nipur made a funny comment here. Said, I keep needing to explain to people that just because I'm arting doesn't mean I'm not serious about my day job anymore.
Me too. I so understand that. So I'm just going to...
That's funny.
Make sure that the shape and... So she's a very, very, like... I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but sometimes noses are way more structured and considered.
And this is another good question by Donna.
Mm, she's wonderful. Saying, hi, Donna. Know,
I guess this sounds
I'm
silly.
I'm getting a higher highlight as we're answering Donna's question.
But is it okay for
the
me?
Right side, adding a higher highlight. I am answering Donna's question.
Oh, no,
sorry.
Sorry.
Know what, I'm doing.
What are you doing? You're on the right.
I'm just making sure that this side of the face, which has the most light on it, has a slightly lighter side of the nose. It's just a small thing, but you'll want it later. Sorry.
Oh, no, no. You're
okay.
So she was saying, I guess this sounds silly, but is it okay for me to take as long as I need to get the result that I want?
Take as long as you need. There isn't... Look. Speed just comes from confidence, right, where I'm not having to think out as many things during the painting process. That's all it is.
And that confidence comes from experience.
And that confidence comes from experience. And as you paint, also, this is your relaxed time. This isn't your, like, hey, let me become a NASCAR driver time. And I'm going to get some white and mix it. I'm going to tone it just a smidge with the skin pigment I have here, but I want it pretty darn close to white. I'm going to come at the top of the nose and make a little highlight here. And then I'm going to come right here at this nostril and make that little highlight. And then just on the outside edge of this, look at that.
Yeah.
And then we're going to come just a little bit up the bridge. Now, isn't that beautiful?
That is.
I love that. Let's get some more of this while we're messing around and come to the outside lip and just add a little bit right there. And then I know I'm going to want a little bit right here. And then down the side. And then maybe right here on the chin. These are just weird little bits that I'm just thinking about. I should probably be messing with the ear, but I got distracted. By the nose, which happens. Yeah. The nose is really fun for me. Okay, so we were saying.
Oh, yeah. Well, if you do have any strange person timing you while you're painting, tell them to knock it off.
Yeah, that's weird.
Yeah.
They should not do that. They need to leave your studio like immediately.
Yeah, it's like, you know.
I know it must seem confusing because as YouTubers, you're always seeing these like 30-second challenge. This challenge. I'm like, that's awesome, but it's also just an underpainting. But yeah. Okay.
And we're, like, part of it is like, you know, there's like YouTube is also entertainment.
It is.
So you have to be entertained while you learn. And that's different than what you have to do in your studio, in your home, and you're by yourself when you're enjoying yourself. So
exactly.
You know, don't always just try to copy what people are doing online or go as fast as they are just because
they are.
It's not necessarily
also, I mean, as video people, we can do like shifty things like speed up the timing of our painting slightly.
Yeah,
like, you might not be able to tell. I see it happen all the time. People edits. Are like, it's real time, but it's not really real time.
It's extra real time.
Extra real time. Wait, like, yeah, one like, and a half time.
But that happens, all, you know, it's like, you know, but these are all tools that we all use. But the point
just
is
disbelieve
that,
a little bit is all we're saying.
Yeah. And don't feel like you have to keep up because we use these tools to make the videos better. Now tell us what you're doing. We're talking shop here. And I am
shading the outer values of my face, darkening them. And then I'm going to come in here.
Yeah.
And just make sure that I am pulling in, you know, these lighter values as I'm going. I'm going to probably add, what was that? Some paint. This lighter value right here.
There's a couple of really... This
right
is a really
to this
good
cheek area. Yeah, I'm going to come with this red makeup in a little bit, but I want to make sure that I'm telling the value story of her face. And already we should start to get the sense of this being a makeup that's over skin.
Yeah.
Which is just my favorite thing. Yes, I know it takes a little while, but it's so worth it. So I'm just lightening this value space here. I'm going to lighten a little value space here, just a smidge, right under the eye here. Now I'm going to start working my foreheads. Foreheads need some work.
Now there's a really good question comment.
Like I made this a longer forehead.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You can...
Freehand it.
So the...
I could literally shorten it. You could. I don't mind, but I'm not going to. It's okay. She's still in proportion, and this is just a thing that happens. I'm just going to let you see me go through it, like when I'm painting.
So Sue is saying, with acrylics here, is it okay for us to stop at some point and then come back to the painting? Or do you need to do it like in one sitting?
Oil painters have to sometimes wait months to painting sessions.
For it to dry.
But that's part of what makes their practice so considered. Is if they're not using accelerants and they're not painting wet into wet, if they're painting in a more traditional method, right?
Yeah.
You know, part of what they're doing, part of what they're embracing, get some of that glazed, is that process of the oil.
Mm.
Right?
But with acrylic, you could stop and then take a break and come back.
You can, take those same breaks. You can have the same benefits. The fact that your paint dries fast does not mean that you have to be just, you know, beholden to that reality. just putting this down. I'm probably have to put that eyebrow back. Gosh darn it. Where'd my eyebrow go?
She's now curious. What are you doing to my eyebrow?
Yeah, she's gotten a little bit more curious than I would like. Definitely probably moving that other eyebrow in a minute. I think I'll get some surgery here. Get her eyebrows relocated. Just want to dust the space here. So it just is, this will be really nice along the hairline. And so this is just what I'm trying to do.
Mm-hmm.
You know, is to create that illusion of space. I'm going to come back and get that rosier tone. And I'm going to get my smaller filbert. Think about her ear for a second. Like you do. Think about her ear.
So Heather Jo just shared a funny story here in Sherpa chat.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. So she says, funny story.
Funny story.
So I use Velcro command strips to hang my paintings. And, uh-huh. You know, those are pretty cool. Those are the, you know, they get the little self-sticky things. You can put them on your wall.
Yeah.
And they don't fall down. So then they're pretty strong. You know, they can hold like 30 pounds. So she's got these. And she says, so she Christian is very sick. And we had to put some Vicks Vapor Rub steamer in the living room. And so they had the, and I guess that's her little brush there.
Yeah.
So they had that going there in the living room, and she said she came back in there, and about an hour later, and about 30 Sherpa paintings came raining off the wall when they closed a door. So, you know, be warned that the command strips and Vicks Vapor Steamers may not
don't
mix.
Work together.
Don't mix.
Might not be a good thing.
That's awesome. Thank you. So you're just straightening out that
I'm rethinking
curious
eyebrow. Yeah. I've got a lot of interior eye to paint, so I've got room. I've got space to be doing it. Get some white here. I think I'll give a little outside highlight to the ear. Okay. So not a lot I got to worry about there. Now I'm going to start thinking about these eyes and these lips like you do.
Mm-hmm.
One of the first things I can do is I can take my brown. I have so much more brown out than I need. My brown and my black together. When you're painting dark eyes, they need to be dark. They're not going to have, a lot of times when we do very fair eyes, there's a lot of detail, luminosity, and eye structure. Mm-hmm. That is revealed. But when you're painting darker eyes, it's about the richness and depth and layer of the color and the reflection. So those are the things that you're going to want to be really thinking about. That's too bright. I'll come darken it in a minute. So I'm going to start getting my... How I did this is a lot of my black and my crimson. And sometimes I warmed it up with my ochre.
Mm.
Sort of a super fun thing. So, you know, just working these things out. Making sure in our sketch that our eye structure is still there. Like you do.
Like you do.
When I have this in, I actually get into my white because I don't want my eyeball to be that bright. So it's going to be about a lot of shading going on in here too, because there's a lot of shadow that we deal with inside the eye structure. Shade it out.
Mm-hmm.
I wish I could say that painting portraits were a speedy biz. I think for some of the daily painters, it can be.
Yeah. You're pretty quick at this. I mean...
Am I? I feel slow.
Oh.
Because, see, whereas you guys have no time pressure, I have huge time pressure.
Well, I mean, like, you know, luckily we don't seem to have... a shortage of hard drive space.
This
and
is true.
We have an unlimited data plan. And
so I'm going to make sure that this lid comes down far. See, this is a lot of where I'm getting that feeling of it being an Asian eye. is the way I'm talking about here. Mm-hmm. And we talked about that a lot. See already, though?
Yeah.
It's like crazy how that works. It's crazy. So cool.
Now,
let's get a little filbert here.
There's a really good, interesting question.
This is a number two filbert. Okay?
Yeah.
These have an unusual amount of stiffness for a filbert in them in an acrylic brush.
Yeah.
Just saying. You got to be grateful. You don't actually have to be grateful. I'm not really trying to be in charge of anybody's gratitude level.
No, let me see that.
Going to start putting the red makeup around. So this is going to be me just trying to get this color kind of laid in and around. And then I will definitely come around the... See, I'm using the glaze.
Mm-hmm.
There'll be lots of value in the red. I'm going to get a little of my black here just to make sure that I have... Come on, my inside line... Just want to make sure that I have the line I'm looking for. See?
Mm-hmm. Everyone's saying, you take all the time you need, Sherpa.
You guys are really patient. I'm so glad anybody was interested in doing this kind of journey this year with the Art Quest, because I really think that once we get these skills down, we can periodically be like just dropping a portrait or two. And also, I think it'd be great by the holidays if everybody felt like they could do portraits as gifts. And that's something I get asked about a lot, is pet portraits, people portraits.
Yeah, we've had a great crowd here tonight. We had right around 400 people.
That is a lot of people learning how to paint faces.
Learning to paint faces today. So, you know, we know that our lives are during the middle of the day in the afternoon. So it can be tough to come and join us. But we really appreciate when you guys do. Don't forget to check out our website, theartsherpa.com/BAQ, where you can find information about the Big Art Quest and the traceables. And all those things are there.
So just
right.
You can see the glazing lets me blend this out beautifully. Like you'd want to. Hey.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're getting that, you know. And then one of the things I'm gonna start doing is I will start laying in my lid. Why am I having so much fun with it? I don't know. It's fun for me to do. So one thing to think about when you're shading this, when you're working these out, is to make sure that you have enough thickness in your lids,
mm-hmm.
above, and that you're shadowing with that in mind. Get a little white here.
Mm-hmm.
All right. I'm going to just come under here. Come to the inside here. Wipe off. I think I even want a little more of the orange,
mm-hmm.
to it. Just start working that out right here. That soft color shadow. Here, and then I definitely want that again here. That nice blending. Let's pull some of that. And it's going to be just working your naphthol and your yellow ochre. And again, I obviously and clearly have way more paint than I necessarily need. I like to warm up some of these red values.
Now you're going for paint.
I'm like getting into it. Now I've got what?
Last time you just looked at your reference. Every once in a while you get me.
Well, it's good to look at what I did before. If I tried to do this out of my own head, I would be lost. You know, I might grab some of this brown and black and coming underneath here because I want this to feel a little. And then I'm going to come here. You know, and just don't forget the power of your glazing medium, being able to blend out what you've got going on. I'm going to take a little of this glazed up here, up the brow. Just valuing it in. So I'm just trying to create this space where we have a highlight here and shadow here at the back and a highlight here and a little highlight under here. And we're just shaping these spaces out. Just enjoying the value changes in that space. When we're painting faces, you know, that's a lot of what we're going to be. Working on. Just trying to think about my eyes here. And also keep the thing that's hard, like, I hope we're doing okay, because, like, I worry when, you know, we're long like this, is the pacing okay? Is everybody feeling all right? I'm going to come with
sure
a highlight right here.
Yeah.
I'm going to make a little.
So what is the difference between glazing medium and airbrush medium?
Airbrush medium is a thinner for fine particle pigments, so you can aerosolize your paint and shoot it out your airbrush.
Ah.
Shoot it out your airbrush.
That makes sense.
Airbrush medium is a fantastic way to create an acrylic colored ground without underbinding, because a lot of artists will create acrylic colored grounds, which is a thinned wash of paint, which underbinds your whole painting. But if you use airbrush medium, you get the same effect, no underbinding.
Ah.
So you'll hear artists like be like talking about that airbrush medium and, you know, what they're trying to do there. But a lot of it is because they're experienced and they're just trying to avoid the underbinding. You'll notice that the black and the red make almost a pinky purple. It's an interesting event.
They do make kind of a pinky purple.
They do. And I like playing with it. I don't know why. You can take a little of it down here.
Yeah, I was just noticing it. It's really interesting how when you add that, it just adds, like, you know, just some humanity to the face.
Yeah, and that's what we've got to do, is we've got to keep adding that there. Create that little highlight right there. It's going to become a more critical highlight. I'm sure I'll be back at it like 6 or 7 times right there. Just, you know, and then maybe a little right here, and then back at here. It's too light. So that's the thing. I'm like, oh, it's too light, or oh, it's too. Just trying to work it out, man. That's what I'm doing, is I'm working it out. So the red makeup is not, you know, a lot of times people see this and go, oh, well, it's like, you know, it's easier. It's actually harder. It's like, how can I aggravate myself just a little bit? You can do this. This is a good way of going. The glazing helps me create a dusted blaze.
Now,
What is the best kind of light to work under when you're setting up your home studio there?
Well, natural light is your best light, but it moves on you and it's unreliable, which is why painters had such limited work times.
Mm-hmm.
So then it's trying to find bulbs, and John will have more info on this specific one, but you want a bulb that gives you as close to a natural light as you can get.
Mm-hmm.
We are not under those, just so you know.
Yep, we're under specialty lights.
We're under Easy Bake Oven lights, and that is always just a...
Yeah.
Just a special, special gift. All right, so I'm just getting here. You can see I'm just working. Get some of my... Point, I'm gonna have to declare her makeup thought out, but yeah. It's not yet. It's just not. It just takes me that long and this much nonsense to work it out.
Now, which brush are you using there?
I am still using this number 2 filbert.
Okay, so this is just a standard. This is not a grass comb. This is just a standard. Standard kind.
Yeah, I'm going to add a little black to my stuff, and I'm going to try to bring off here, coming around kind of a shadow.
Hmm. So
I'm going to start coming here with kind of a shadow.
Jesse's got a really interesting question.
I have a really interesting answer if you hang in with me while I work out what's going on with my eyes here.
How do you know if your stroke is perfect for your painting?
There isn't a perfect stroke that's for a painting. That's
What about like the size of the brush? How do you know what size brush you need to make a stroke?
So if you find that you're straining, you need to change the size of your brush.
Okay.
Right? If as you're working, you're like, wow, I am really struggling here.
Like you're just like, I got to paint all this space, and I'm just like, paint. You maybe need to upsize. Yeah.
You really might.
Or if you're having to really fight to use the corner of a brush, maybe you need to go down a little bit.
Exactly. If you're just at war in your painting, check the size of your brush. You may have just really, really just gone.
Yeah.
All right. I just keep. I'll do this all day is my problem. I will. I'll go all day. But now I'm going to start getting inside these eyes here and start working out what's happening inside. So believe it or not, another coat of the,
And this is about those layers again here in the eyes too,
brown.
Huh?
Yeah, I really, and also making sure that this one isn't some crazy different size than its friend.
Well, because then she's not curious that she's, you know. Maybe
she's
had
like
a head
having
injury.
A minute, right?
Yeah, bonked her head on something.
This is no good. It's just no good. All right. So I've got my I find that I like my red, my brown, and my black. A little more to the red.
Yeah.
I want to wipe that off. And I'm going to start kind of working and glazing inside the eye. So, even a little bit on the tear duct. Come around. I'm going to just darken this up quite a lot. And you're so like, wait, I gave her pink eye. Why'd you do that? You gave her pink eye.
Irene was saying she stepped away to go tend something away from the computer and came back and saw your palette and was like, OMG, you have done a lot of mixing there.
Yes.
So this, and that's true. In this painting, you're going to...
There's just micro mixes and mixes and mixes and mixes. And when we do sometimes more challenging portraits, especially as we notice that I'm creating a shadow right here at the back of this eye. This is very important. The shadow at the back of the eye. Grab some pure black. just pulling this. See?
Yeah.
We're not playing. Now we're going for it. Don't want to wipe off. I don't want to take all the color out of my brush, but I need to lighten it so I offload. I'm going to come get into my white here. Start coming under here, leaving some of my shadow coming around my eye, and then leaving again a good portion of my shadow. And this is a gray. So you see, I'm building up this space.
Yeah. So now,
you know, in a slow manner.
So this allows you to add those layers.
Yeah, which I need. So the back of the eye here. And I may even fiddle down to that grass filbert again.
Oh, yeah?
So this is how you know. You're like, I'm struggling here to get the space, the brush, you know, this where I want it. So it's time to... And so right here, it's just a little corner light. A lot of shadow is going to be happening all around there. And this is a lot of what we're dealing with is like our shadow.
Mm.
Lots of glaze. No, so right under here. You know, just making sure that you have that shadowing in the eye is a big deal, especially under a low-lidded eye. So, you know how you're going to keep the beauty of the eye and the drama of the eye.
Yeah.
Is, you know, see those shadows. Now, I'm going to wipe off but not go completely white. That little bit of pigment hanging into my brush is a big deal. Get a little more right here. Just come right to the back a smidge. And right here to the front. And then just a smidge back here. Alright. Now I'm going to get into my black. I'm going to come around this eye. Or make sure it's round and full and focused. I might even dust out that shadow just a bit, right?
Because
I'm trying to really, really, really emphasize my drama. Right. Apply shadow here, but I don't want to make a pupil. That's really not what I want. I want it, think of it more as a beautiful glass marble that you're shadowing out. You know, and you're trying not to. Yeah, we're doing pretty good here.
Yeah. She's coming right along.
Yeah, she is. She's all right. She's okay. So when I have her in like that, then I can come and I can get a little of my brown and come right here. I don't want to put it everywhere. I just want a little bit in this reflection. And a little bit maybe right here. As if some of the color and richness of the eye has been picked up. So I've got my little rosy color here. I'm going to bring it out. My rosy rose. I'm going to even add a little more rose to it. A little more crimson. Come right here. Maybe just a little bit along here. See that?
Yeah.
It's sometimes it's the small things are going to make some huge differences. And then maybe just a little bit. And actually lighter than that. Go even lighter than that. It's a small thing. But you want it. I might. Just a little bit there. So once I have that, you want your off gray, right? And your white. You just don't want a pure white here. And you're going to want to add a smidge of a reflection. Notice how low the eye. I left a lot of lid shadow and room and all that. I didn't take it way up high. Right? Then I'm going to get a little red. Just a little red. And I'm going to come right along what would be this lash line here. And I'm going to touch just a little bit of that lash line. You see
wow,
that?
Wow, yeah. That's just that little tiny highlight. Just yeah. Goes.
I'm going to come back and zoom in. Big, big, important
difference.
Already
zoomed in as much as I can go. Didn't know.
All right. So did the same thing there. Lashes on her, be light and not that specific about. So I'm just going to do corners. Maybe a couple. Not too much, though, because it's real easy to just have it go.
Cover girl?
Not authentic, and it's frustrating.
Yeah.
So you want to have them, but not a lot. And even then, I'm not sure. Aesthetically, I don't know if it adds anything to the piece. But they were there. So now they're here. All right, so there you go. There's a little bit of that going on.
Wow, that's a lot of work there in the eyes.
Yeah, I know. Sorry.
Oh, no, it's awesome.
Just like, we here for a minute. You know.
It seems like that the rest of it, the robes and the hair would
that,
go.
The hair goes in 2 seconds. The robes go in 2 seconds. And it is the contrast to the consideration that we put in our girl here. Make a little shadow here coming under the lip. And a little shadow there. Right?
Uh-huh.
Important stuff. So, first I'm going to be putting in this darker red with a little tone with a little bit of black. And I will paint in the base of my lips. With that thought. Base of this lip. Also, what it's going to be is about the highlights on these.
Yeah.
And leaving the shadows where you have to have shadows. So I'm going to get a little of my orange here and I'll pull out a little white. And perhaps there's a smidge. I need this to be a little bit redder. These are subtle bits.
Mm.
Smidge of a
now, we've done a drawing video on how to trace this in.
How to draw her in.
We also have a traceable.
We, you know, really all you've got to do is commit. I've grabbed some orange here. You just got to commit to who she is and the time it takes to make her. I'm going to pull some highlight on the lower lip.
And you can find
a little too orange.
All that stuff out there at theartsherpa.com/bigartquest.
Yeah.
There's a link to the video where we drew her in and to the traceable
and to all of the other resources we have. There's some images that Cinnamon's done, some sketches of...
We studied eyes and how they were built.
Yeah.
So that when we make her, she feels like herself. Right? Because that's really what you want, is you want her to feel like... I don't know what I'm talking about today.
We wanted to give you all the resources you could, all you need for the, you know, for nose, eyes, lips, all those. And
so you can see how those are kind of coming in, right?
Mm-hmm. And you can go back through older Big Art Quest missions or adventures and see the, you know, we have other resources where we've gone in and drilled down on placements of eyes and nose and mouth so that you can have all sorts of help with that.
Yeah. So we got a little shadow popping a little bit under the lip, like you would, you know, like you do.
Like you do.
Like you do. Darken that a little bit right there.
I'm pretty happy with that?
I'm getting there.
Yeah?
She's not, you know... I'm telling you, you could just spend a day with a portrait.
Just tuning.
Just tuning, yes. Finding her, finding your space, finding your highlights, tuning. You can spend a whole lot of time, though I have to say that the gel really slowed down my paint drying time.
Oh, yeah?
So I'm going to just take this and just put a...
Ooh, that's cool.
Highlight right here. Just so that we can see that. And then just the softest thought of one right there. You know, so we've got that and got a nice shadow there. I think we could add some nice eyebrows. That's always appreciated. I bet she'd like some. She's probably like, eyebrows would be great. So I'm making this interesting sort of red-gray that's lighter. And then I'm going to come here and kind of put that pink in and remember to change the directionality of the hair at the top of the brow, like we talked about. Just so it has a thing. And then I'm going to come get into my black. Not even rinse my brush. It's sort of an interesting thing. And I'm going to just enjoy lightly. I like that. Putting those in. I really like doing these. So now that all this is done, we're literally nearly almost done. It's going to trip you out, y'all.
Wow.
How long you have left in this painting. So it's like slow, 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 slow. Quick, 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 quick. Let's see how we're just sort of telling that story. To grab just a little bit of white paint, put it right there, and maybe just right under the eye right here.
Oh, wow.
Sorry.
Picky. Oh, I like it.
Picky, picky. Just to complete my little fairy tale. All right. Now that she's this far, I'm going to get one of my very favorite tools. What we all know I like, a bright. I'm going to get this number 6 bright. And I'm going to come dampen my brush lightly, pull out just a smidge of white paint. Oh, guess what I get to put out? My Prussian blue.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Now we get to get the blue.
Now we're there. Everything here. Now you're going to loosen up and get abstract. It is the contrast of the areas of this piece that are very tight and regimented versus the parts that are very loose that I think, for me personally, make it wonderful. And I'm going to come lightly sketch out some of the outline of what I'm seeing here. And see, I just am very light about it. And then just lightly brush
push, push.
Curving. See how light it is? I'm letting the brush do the work.
Why are you curving there?
To imply the wonderful roll and shape of her hair.
So the you use the curvedness of the line to help imply the curvedness of the hair.
I'm going to get some more blue. And I'm going to come above this line with just this blue. I may even come back with some black to get rid of it. That there, because I just want that to really... And then just a little bit here. And now I'm going to get some white. More thought white. And right here, make a reflection. Where the hair is shiny and really, really pushing back some light. So we can really feel the structure and form of that.
Mm-hmm.
And then around her face, just a little bit of hair, hairline.
Oh, yeah.
Just small, not too much. And I've got this mixture on here. Shoulder. Look at these light, like less here is so much more.
You're just implying some of the color and texture
of
there.
The kimono. So see her being resolved in this way, and I'm gonna get a smaller bright just real quick because I want to do the sticks.
Okay.
Her being resolved in this way allows the most important part of the story being her face. When you take something and you make some of it really thought out and processed, and then you take some of it and get loose with it, you're telling the viewer important things about your subject. And I think this is important when we're doing portraits, is think about what you're putting emphasis on. I'm going to then grab some yellow. Might even let it be some of that with the red in it. And I'm going to come and...
Now, what would you use if you didn't have Prussian blue around?
Any blue I had. I mean, I think blue, that probably phthalo, if I didn't have Prussian.
Yeah.
Windsor or something like that. I'm just trying to show the little highlight of the wire wrap. So I have those there. Hopefully you guys can see those. And we're going to highlight them again in a second. Let me get back into this. So I'm going to take a little of my black in my red, which I already had here. And I'm going to come here. I'm going to pull this down, not all the way to the bottom. And then along this. Just loose. I'm going to get some of this brighter color that I had. Gosh, my plant palette is so messy. Look at me trying to find a spot. Add it for some highlights. Super light, though. So the red feels more red, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And then I'm going to get a small... fiddly little bright. This is a number two. And I'm going to grab just some ochre and some white. I don't mind if some of the color that's around it picks up. And I'm going to make some impressionistic flower shapes. Use some of my Prussian and my yellow ochre to make some green. So you've implied some kimono here. And then, just to be cheeky, because I am a little of the red and white, which will really pop as if this is a... There she is. Now,
wow.
Signatures.
Ooh, signature time.
On a piece like this, think about your signature. It's really going to impact her. and change the quality of who and how she is. So definitely. This is a number one monogram liner. This is actually one of the brushes I put in my sets. Just because I thought it was pretty cool. I'm just grabbing a little blue and white. And I'm going to put my signature right here.
I'm going to zoom in up here.
See how it makes it part of the work.
Wow.
So that it doesn't detract from who she is or what she has going on in any way.
Well, gosh, man.
Dude, we did this live. I was like, when I designed this, I was like, what? This is crazy. Why would I do this live?
Well, thank you, guys. We've had a great crowd out here today. They've all been hanging out with us.
I hope this was informative on how you'd paint something like this and what you do. Feel free to use the sketch through. Feel free to use the traceable. I hope you paint her. I hope you enjoyed her as much as you did Galactic Soul. I can't wait till we meet up next week for the next big art quest, because you know it's going to be something wild and crazy. I'm telling you, by Christmas. What are we going to be painting, John? Portraits.
Portraits.
We're going to be so confident. We're going to be like, I just add people to my paintings whenever I feel like it. I
always feel so put on the spot here. I'm like, I know.
By the way, I'm just going to say that I feel like her forehead got a little big, but I don't know if angle.
I like how high her hair is there. I think it looks cool.
Yeah, I think I moved it up when I sketched her, and I think I needed to put it right about there.
Maybe. I think it just depends on your hairstyle.
talk and paint. Does it to you.
I think it looks great.
I love her. But I hope you guys love yours, and I want to see you guys at the easel really soon.
Love you guys.